Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this episode where we discuss the Decorator design pattern, a new episode in our design pattern series. We will actually discuss a bit more than Decorator. I decided to combine this with Adapter because, as you will see, they are quite similar, and I will explain with this occasion the differences between them as well. And of course, this by implementing the two design patterns and then giving you the right examples from real world scenarios where you could use these design patterns. With that being said, if you are watching the event live, don't forget that you can write me questions and messages in the live chat directly. If you are watching the event recorded, you can still ask questions in the comment section, or you can find me on LinkedIn or Twitter, and we can discuss there as well. Let's start our discussion with the Decorator design pattern. So, as usual, I do remind you what a design pattern is. Is a solution to a common problem, to a common design problem. We have already discussed some design patterns in this series, so in case you missed them, in the past episodes we discussed observer pattern and we discussed builder as well, with nice examples. MVC, I think. Now, for the adapter and the decorator design patterns, I will tell you the same. So they are solutions to common problems we find when we have to design our application. And in case of the decorator, so do I have whiteboard here? So in case of the decorator, we have this situation where you might have the same functionality, somehow the same responsibility implemented in different ways, but you want to combine them. So maybe not even the same the same responsibility, but that's what's most likely in real world scenarios. But in, generally speaking, you have these actions that can be combined in different ways, and in specific situations you want to be able to somehow combine to make several combinations of these actions. So imagine you have three operations, let's call them O1, O2 and O3, and imagine what would you have to implement. Well, in case you would like to be able, depending on some configurations, or maybe not necessarily some configurations, but differently throughout the code, sometimes only execute O1, otherwise only execute O2, another times only execute O3, maybe at some point you want to both execute O1 and O2, maybe you want to execute O1 and O3, at some point you want to be able to execute O2 and O3, and so on and so forth. And you can see that, of course, we have a large number of combinations, and the number of combinations might become even larger with the numbers of operations you want to combine together. So how do you design the code in such a way in which it's easier to combine the operations whenever you need to do so, in any way possible, and in any order, if you'd like so, if you want possible, without having to duplicate code, without having to write more code than necessary. How do you implement something like that in as well in a maintainable way? And that's basically what the decorator patterns teaches us, what we use the decorator pattern for. When we have such a case in which we have multiple operations and we want to be able to combine them in any number and any order in an efficient way, this is where we use decorator. And now, O1, O2, O3 might be difficult to understand, so let's actually give them some names. Let's now take an example which sounds more realistic. I just named them O1, O2, O3, O n. They can be whatever number you'd like, but let's make this even easier to understand. So say we have to send notifications, because that's quite a situation where I even myself I found it in practice at some point. And it's from my point of view easy to understand. So let's say you have an application, a server application that sends notifications to the users, and now you have different ways of sending the notifications depending on how the user configures it. So maybe you will send them emails, like for example YouTube sends you an email when my live starts. At some point you want to be able to send them SMS messages. Maybe you want to send them push notifications. So and so on and so forth, and you don't even know in the future if you don't need to implement more kind of notifications the user can configure. So maybe at some point you need to implement several other ways of sending the same notification, and the user can configure that. So they might want to only get emails, they might want to only get SMS messages, they might want to only get push notifications, or in the app at some point you might want to send them both SMS and push notifications, maybe all three of them. Maybe in the future there can be 4, 5, 6 even more kinds of notifications. And what we want to do is structure our code in such a way in which the sending of the notifications can be done in a maintainable way without, again, without replicating too much code, by keeping the responsibilities apart, making the app easy to read and easy to understand and easy to develop further. And maybe in this case it's not even a complete example of mine, because as I told you earlier when I was discussing and I said operations, I also said that the order might be important. Of course, in that case, in this one here, you might realize that the order is not that important, because it doesn't really matter if you send first an email or an SMS, because you anyway don't know exactly when will they arrive. But remember that in other examples you might even depend on the order in which the operations occur. So you might want a specific operation to be before or after the other for some reason, we don't care now why. In this case it doesn't apply, but that's still something that Decorator solves in case it's a requirement. So if that's a requirement, that's also covered by Decorator. Of course, now that was for you to understand the problem. Now let's solve the problem. So how do we implement something like this? How do we design our code so that we can make these things easier to send in any combination? And for that, I think we should start coding a bit. And if things become difficult, I will step again into the visuals. But let's start our example. So what would be this one? Design patterns, episode 4, I guess, is this one. Maybe I will discuss later another example. So let's make it _1. And let's open this project. And let's start from our idea with the notifications. So I'll simply create here a package. And inside it, let's say we have an interface first that we say is called notification sender. So the notification sender is actually an interface, maybe containing a method, just to make it more realistic. And I won't complicate the code too much, because we want to focus on our design pattern. But the idea is that now what will I actually do? I do implement the interface, and I create two at least of these. Say we have email and SMS, and then you will realize further that you can basically add as many as you wish to the case. So in my case here, I will say email sender. And the email sender, of course, implements the notification sender. And of course, if I made it contain an abstract method in the interface, then I have to override it. So let's override the send and say here something like sending email notification. So that's one of the things, and then the second one would be the SMS notification, SMS sender, that implements my notification sender. And override the method. And then say here something like sending SMS. So with this being here, if I create a main class, then I can combine the two, but it's rather difficult to combine them anytime I want to implement something based on a group of the events. So as you will see I have an operation needing to send an SMS an email. Now what I have to do is basically I need to create an object of the type email sender, an object of the type SMS sender, and then call both send messages from either one of them, which is not really okay. And if in the future I need to add something else, then the combining them together is even more difficult. So that's basically, you know, I'm starting without implementing the pattern itself, and then I will add the pattern so that you can see the advantage that comes with the pattern. So I have the SMS sender, and then I have to call send and send again if I want to send the two. And if I want to reverse the order, I can reverse the order by replacing the order of the methods. But that doesn't create any coupling between these kinds of operations. So instead of making it like this, what we can do is make one of them wrap the other. So I can make that the email sender contains an object of type notification sender. So observe that is the same type of interface here. So I will call it sender, and then I will make sure that I create a constructor that gets the value of the sender. And now it depends. In some cases you would like to make this null allowed, in other cases you might not necessarily want to do so. Usually you do make it final, because that's better to make it immutable. When you create some object of that type, you make sure that what you decorate never changes. And anyway, immutability is a good practice in most cases, so I do recommend you think for immutability wherever you can in such situations. But now what happens is that before executing the sending of the email notification, then what you will do is, now depending on if you allow or not the sender to be null, you can just say sender is not null or and send, or simply throw an exception in the constructor to make sure that you never get the parameter as being null. That's basically that's one of the cases. Or you can wrap it in an optional to make it even more easier to observe that you allow that parameter to be optional. But let's make it simple for the moment, because I want to focus again on the design pattern and not on the on the other clean coding aspects. And basically the same thing, I will implement the same thing in the SMS sender. So I just say private final notification sender, and then I implement the constructor getting the parameter. So it'd be like this, and then my send will always be, observe that in my case I do allow nulls, so I have to check for that, and call the send message, the send method. So what happens here is that now, instead of creating the two objects independent one of the other, I do group them in a group of operations, because that's basically what the decorator helps you do. So you can basically add functionality over some other functionality of a different object, basically making them independent one of the other, so that you can combine them in whatever order you'd like and whatever combination you'd like. So in my case here, now what I can say is notification sender is new email sender of a new SMS sender of null, because I decided that I will leave that null allowed. Again, maybe in a better approach from the clean code perspective would have been to at least create a no args constructor here, or use optional behind the scenes, or both of them. But again, it's not related to the subject of our today's discussion. Or I can say new SMS sender of new email sender. And imagine I would have more different types of senders. Like I can have the push notification sender as well, and I can have in the future as many as I would like. You can combine them basically in any possible order. So being that these are always relying on the notification sender interface, and all of them are implementing that, you can basically just combine them like pieces of puzzle, maybe not even puzzle, like Lego pieces, actually, in any shape you'd like. So you can put them in any order you'd like, so you can use them independent. I can use an email sender like solo alone, or I can use it together with an SMS sender. And when I use it together with the SMS sender, I can choose that I use it together with the SMS sender in this order, or I can decide to use them in the reverse order, depending if the order of the operations is or not important. So now when I say S1 send, it will basically automatically refer to the entire group of objects. And it's called decorator because the email sender in this case decorates the SMS sender, and it's basically one object decorates another, meaning that it relies on its implementation, but it enhances its implementation inside its own implementation. So in my case here, for example, if I call S1 send, it will send an email and an SMS, basically, because the email sender is wrapping the SMS sender. And of course, you can just change the order by reversing them. So in case I'm calling S2 send, then it will basically send them in the in a different reverse order. We can see the difference easier if we make it like this. And again, the two objects, basically now the email sender and the SMS sender, they can be used independently, or they can be used grouped, so one wrapping the other. And being that we rely on the interface, we can even make an object rely on itself. So there are cases where you might want an operation to depend on the same operation, so you can basically wrap as many as you'd like. So now this instance of SMS sender decorates this one, and this one decorates this one. So you have a very big flexibility. There is no limit in how many objects can decorate another. That's basically the way in which decorator works. Oh, sorry, I forgot to call S3 send here, so that we can see that for the third example, there will be three SMS notifications sent, because we decorated three objects. So that's basically the decorator. And where you find this in real world scenarios, if anyone asks you Where do we find something like this implemented? In the JDK, for example, I think the best example is the IO streams. So referring to the IO streams, let's create a separate package here. You will be able to see that's working very similarly in an example. And you write something like buffered reader in is new buffered reader, and then this is a high level stream and you always need to decorate a low level stream, so input stream reader and then whatever you have here, file input stream and so on and so forth. Okay, something like that. Anyways, so yeah, this is basically an example of classes that implement, that decorate something in the JDK. So in terms of the streams, IO streams, they are decorating one another. And you can see basically, if you go into the classes, I think that could be a good way to see the pattern itself. So you see the buffered reader, extends reader, the input stream reader, extends reader itself, and that's basically how it works. So the buffered reader decorates any reader, same as in our case here, the SMS sender is a notification sender and decorates another notification sender. So buffered reader is a reader and decorates another reader. So this is an example from the JDK. The number of classes you have that decorate one another is customizable, and you will find different customizations again of this pattern. Like you will observe that in this case, for example, the input stream reader is not designed to all decorate itself another reader. So you see that this is only like the end of the tree, the leaf of the tree, so it doesn't decorate itself another stream. So in our case here, the buffered reader is a reader and can decorate itself or any other implementation of a reader. And the input stream reader is basically only usable as the leaf, as the end of the chain of decorations. So you can use it you can decorate it with a buffered reader, but you cannot decorate something else with it. So that's possible. Another difference that you might observe is that the same thing might apply with using classes and no interfaces. So in general, in books, you will find, and if I were to design something like that, because the interfaces are the contracts, I would rather rely on interfaces because they are the definition of the behavior when implementing a decorator pattern. But you can basically use classes as well, because in terms of inheritance, they are similar for this situation. So you can simply have a class, and the polymorphism in Java works the same here for classes as well as for interfaces. So that's why here, for example, you see that the decorator is implemented using an upper class and not an upper interface, but it's again the same pattern behind the scenes. So that's basically the decorator with an example of where you can find it. And let's compare this decorator now to adapter, because my feeling is that adapter is basically very similar, and my feeling is that a lot of people make confusions between these two. Basically, a lot of my students actually make confusion between of these two, and sometimes they are even used together, so it doesn't necessarily mean that they have to exclude one another. Remember that the design patterns are not necessarily exclusive, so you might use design patterns together. Maybe it's time to take a pause and take some questions. So let's see, maybe next time you'll present us adapted design pattern and explain the differences. I'm doing that now, actually, so it's not for next time, it's just for now. And then, hi Lawrence, thanks for making such in-depth tutorials. I watched almost. Okay, so it's not a question. Thank you very much for the appreciation. If you have questions, let me know. Yes, and a video regarding the adapter, that's what comes now, so it's not for next time. I'm happy to tell you that we still have a lot of time, and we have basically time to discuss the adapter as well. So let's take it in a second example. So that will be DPE4_2, and with the adapter, basically, the adapter is very similar because, again, you decorate something somehow, just that the difference is that in case of adapter, the first of all, the purpose is not the same, so we don't group operations like we do in the case of the decorator. You see, in case of the decorator, we had different implementations, and the reason we create a decorator is just to somehow group them so such that in a way that they can enhance one another, and that gives us the possibility of either using them separately or using them together in any combination. So the most the purpose of this design pattern of the decorator is basically the possibility of using these operations in any combination you'd like. So they're giving you the flexibility to use them in any combination, like you have seen in my example. But in the case of the adapter, the purpose of the adapter is slightly different. The purpose of the adapter is wrapping an object, same as we did with the decorator, but this time to change from an interface to another. And that's really it's a really hard way to, if I explain it like that, I'm certain that you might not necessarily understand it right. So I want to give you an example, like I did for the decorator as well. So let's say you have two different modules of your application. These modules can be two different frameworks. They can be two different modules, actually, like jar files that contain classes and need to communicate one with the other. They can be two different modules, like actually in the terms of jigsaw modules in a Java application, for those of you aware of the Java 9 plus functionalities. They can be two different libraries. These two, I will continue calling them modules, but the idea is that they are basically two different parts of the application that needs to represent the same object in two different ways. And after I explain you on the diagram and I make you an example of a simple adapter, I would also show you the most encountered for myself case where I used basically an adapter, where I wrapped a specific object to adapt it to some other interface, which is related to Spring Security, which is one of my favorite technologies. So imagine that these two, they both use the same object, but with different representations. So for example, they both use an object called notification. Now going back to notification, because I will just keep the same example. So notification. So I have the representation A, which is, or maybe that should be B, just to, or maybe that even that should even be 2, just to say module 2 has a notification implementation, which we will call notification 2. And then you need to create here your own notification in module 1, but you need to use module 2. So the question is, how do you implement your classes in such a way in which you can use them in both modules? Like I can use, say, them in my application with its representation, and I can as well use it in a way in which the second module knows it. So that's a very common case when you use different libraries or different technologies that refer to the same object. And basically, to solve this problem, which is the solution being actually the adapter design pattern, you just have to find a common interface, the interface you need that can be used in your application, and then wrap the object into the other one. So you just make notification one contain the notification two instance and delegate to the notification two accordingly. So again, like in the case of the decorator, the adapter supposes that one object wraps the other one and delegates. But the purpose is not enhancing the functionality with each one, but basically adapting the functionality to the other one so that both sides of the application can use their representations and at the same time work together. So what does this look like? Well, say you have in your application a representation of the notification called notification implementation one, and that's something you need to work with. And actually make it even more easier to understand if I create a package dependency. See, I'm using a dependency, so this notification implementation one, it's actually some notification from the dependency, and say it contains some attribute, private, string, text. So in this case, basically what you can do, is not really the best choice, sorry. So not really the best choice, because it's not really common that you wrap modal classes. So maybe even make it more realistic would be to consider this is notification sender implementation, and void send, and then you have to use it in your application, and in your application you have another class called app notification sender, and the app notification sender is of a specific interface. Like in the case of the other app, I could say notification notification sender, we'll call it this one, this is the dependency notification sender. So the dependency notification sender has a method, and then your app notification sender implements the notification sender interface. And then the question is, I can only use this implementation here because I need in my application to use an implementation of this interface. That's because in my application, this is the interface representing the notification sender. But somehow I need now to use this dependency that comes with a class, which of course doesn't implement the notification sender interface. So being that in a real world scenario is not something that your app defines, but it's something you import from a library, you cannot change it. So I cannot simply just go here and make it implement the needed interface. So instead of implementing the needed interface, I make this notification sender just wrap the dependency notification sender, and then whatever method I have here, which can be called differently than send, can be, say, send notification. Because you see, that's basically the main difference with the decorator here. We don't have, we don't necessarily have the same operation. So here we can say public void send notification to override the method. And then you can do just call the other one send. So now your application can continue to use your implementation based on the write contract, but at the same time creates an adapter, adapts the call to the other class which comes from the dependency, so you can use them together without needing somehow to independently separate them. So it's the way to adapt an object you have in your application to something you get from a dependency and you cannot change. And again, it relies again on wrapping objects. So this most likely would be something like final, and then you would have to make sure you get the dependency here. So in such a case, very often you would even make it mandatory, so throw an exception in case it comes null. So you see, they look very close one to the other, so that's why they are often confused one with the other, but they have different purposes. So the purpose in case of the adapter is simply adapt an interface in your application, so make another object which kind of represents the same thing usable. Because when you use different libraries, you just get a library somebody implemented at some point, but it doesn't necessarily mean it will be compatible with what you have in your code. So you can't simply change all your code just because you want to use that specific new interface. And instead of changing your code, you just create an adapter to wrap that in an object of yours, which implements the right interface, and then adapt the call. And that's basically, again, because I was telling you that I would like to show you where we, for example, where I very often encounter a need of the adapter, an example with a real world implementation. When you do use, for example, Spring Security, for those of you who don't know, has its own representation of the user, which is called the user details. So if you want to use Spring Security, you are forced to use user details to represent the user. If you don't do that, Spring Security won't understand your user. So if you want to implement somehow the user, it really needs to be implementing the Spring Security the user details interface from Spring Security. So say I'm here, so DP E43. So this is a Spring Boot example where I will just use Spring Security and say that I'm using Spring Data because I'm storing my user somewhere in a database. And you will soon see where I want to go. So let me just create the example first. And what happens is that if I'm now trying to represent the user from the database, I need to implement, because I'm using JPA implementation, I need to implement an entity class. And usually when you implement an entity class, it has to define the fields according to the database table we represent. So I will simply assume here that we have a table user, and if I'm to implement here a JPA entity, then I will just simply say, well, I have an ID, and then I have, say, a username and the password, and let's just say that this is everything I have in my table. Okay, and then we will have all the other annotations from the JPA, but that's not relevant. The idea is that our table in the database has a specific structure. It has a specific format. For example, in my case, it has an ID, a username, and a password. It might have the user's email address. It might have the user's first name, last name. Just imagine it has some kind of a shape. But if I am now to use this in Spring Security, then I would need to use to define a user details interface. So say I'm using now this user from the database to create some authentication implementation. So if I'm creating some authentication implementation in Spring Security, then what I definitely need to do is to make sure I have a user class. Let's call it security user, that implements the user details interface. And then of course, it has to override all the methods from the user details interface. So let's override them. So what you will basically observe is that the user details implementation has some methods, and some of the attributes might be the same, but not necessarily all of them. So you can see that, for example, there is no email in the user details, and there is no first name in the user details. There is no ID in the user details. So the two classes, they look totally different, don't they? Not totally, maybe, but they have things in common, but they are different representations of the same thing. One is the user, the way my application needs to keep it. The other way is the user, the way Spring Security needs to understand it. And we definitely need here to use this implementation, because if you don't make it implement the user details interface, then Spring Security won't understand the implementation, and you could not use it. So we are forced to have a class implementing the user details. So one option to do that would be to make this user class implement the user details interface, and you can definitely do that. But if you do that, if you have the entity and then you implement the user details as well, what happens is that now you mix two different responsibilities, and you are against a very important principle defined in what we call the solid principles, that S, which is called the single responsibility, because now you will basically have a class with at least two responsibilities. One of them defining the user of your application that maps the table, the entity that maps the table in the database, and secondly the user that is used by Spring Security to implement the authentication and further the authorization. So implementing the user details interface here is not really a good choice. Trust me, you can try it. You will see that the code anyway will look horrible in the end. So even if you try to do that, you will see that not only it contains two responsibilities, but it definitely looks very bad. So instead, what you do separate the classes, but you need to adapt one class to the other. So instead of mixing the two responsibilities, we define a different implementation that will be used by Spring Security. Now we have the class, and we adapt the entity to this implementation by saying public final user where user here is actually the one we defined in the entities, so this one. And of course, create a constructor to make sure that you assign that user. And then you can now just adapt it the way you need it. So you can just say, if it has authorities, in our case it doesn't, the password, let's create some getters and setters as well to be able to call it. So now I can say the password will be user get password, the username will be user get username, and you can basically do that with all the needed methods. So you accordingly decorate our user, the user of our application, to make it, to give it a shape in which Spring Security understands it. So it's called adapter because you adapt a representation of an object to another representation so that you can use it in a specific place. Like in our case, we adapt the representation of the entity in our application to a representation of the user that can be understood by Spring Security. And wherever you have a situation like this one, where you have specific, you have to define an object you already, that already exists in a specific way, where it needs to be used by a different technology library module, you can adapt it to the right interface by wrapping that object and delegating the methods the way it fits best for that situation there. So this is basically what we call adapter. So that's what we do with an adapter. So again, decorator and adapter, they basically look very similar. The technique is the same because it's wrapping an object. The purpose is different. So when you implement a decorator, one of the things is that, I'm not sure if I have it still opened, I don't think I have it, I closed the window, but you will always have one interface. So you don't, when you do have an adapter, you transform an object into another object. So the purpose is just to somehow have a different interface to another object. So there are two different interfaces in the end, two different ways to object look like, which is not the case of decorator, because in case of the decorator, all of your objects will be of that kind of interface, like buffered reader and input stream reader, they both implement reader. So with the decorator, you don't change one interface to another. Both of the objects, they have the same interface, so they fulfill the same contract. But you wrap them to enhance, to be able to customize and enhance their functionality with one another. But you don't have two different interfaces. You always have one interface in the decorator. While in the case of the adapter, you always have two different interfaces, because the logic of the adapter, the purpose of the adapter is adapt from one interface to another. So you wrap the objects not to enhance their functionality, but to change their interface from one another. And of course, you can combine the two if you want to both enhance the functionality as well as transform from one to another. But when we think about the two design patterns, they have two different purposes, even though they look very similar because they use the same technique, wrapping an object. They do two different things. The decorator doesn't change the interface, it only helps you customize use the objects grouped together or separately in any combination possible, as we demonstrated earlier today. While in the case of the adapter, the main purpose is changing from a way an object looks like to another, so that two different technologies that are using the same app can understand that entity you have there. Like in my case here, the user, my application now understands the user. So Spring Data understands the user, Spring Data JPA, the JPA implementation understands the user, which needs to have this way, this representation, because it obviously needs to correctly define the columns as in the table. While Spring Security needs a different way of representing the user, which is defined by the user details contract. So to have a solution for both of them, for both Hibernate, the JP implementation, and Spring Security to be happy, we need to find a way to represent the same in two different ways. And the best solution is wrap the one of the objects into another, so that you adapt its this way its shape to the other shape needed by the other technology that needs the object. And again, you can do that. You can adapt this object if needed in different other shapes. So it's not necessarily only two. You can then adapt this one to another shape. Say you need, you need to use a different technology, and that one needs to use the user but in a different way. Then you will basically do the same thing. You will wrap the user and adapt it to that specific interface. And I hope with this I have covered all and everything you need to understand for the both the adapter and the decorator. I see no other questions in the chat, so if you still have questions after the event, don't forget that you can anytime contact me through the comment section of the video or on LinkedIn and Twitter, and I will try to clarify your questions. Otherwise, thank you very much for joining this event again. Have an excellent time for learning further, and see you for the next episode. Cheers!